So David, thanks so much for being willing to talk to us. You know that yesterday was World Mental Health Day. And I know that you've struggled with mental health in the past. Can you just tell us a little bit about your experience and what it's like to struggle with mental health?
So I would say not just in the past, I'd say for the last pretty much my whole adult life, from age 16, 17 to age 27. You know, it's varied in that time from being better and worse, but yeah, it's an ongoing thing. So I had a bit of sort of family problems, and my dad was very, very ill, thought he might pass away. Thank God he didn't when I was young, 16. And then off the back of that, I kind of did the classic kind of, oh, let's man up and suck it all in and get on with it and, you know, go off to uni and do a hard degree and, you know, choose a degree that's not fun, it's something serious to get a good job afterwards, because that's what manning up means, apparently, to 18-year-old me anyway. And then, you know, I had kind of struggles with disability that I didn't know I had. And all that kind of combined into a very sort of, it kind of started breaking down. And, you know, I started developing sort of severe anxiety and moderate depression.
Just give us a little insight. What is it actually like struggling with anxiety and depression? Like, what's going on in your head?
Yeah, definitely. So anxiety and depression are kind of quite different, but they're very, very sort of linked often. Anxiety is sort of, I guess, best defined as like a fight or flight response that's just kind of got ramped up 500% with nowhere to go. So imagine that you're kind of always, you know, that feeling when you sort of, something startles you and you feel your kind of, your heart quickens and you take that breath because you're that moment of, oh, what's going to happen. Imagine having that physical response, like 24/7. You know, you can't sleep because you're too jittery. You can't concentrate because you're always kind of having that flight or fright response. Your heart races, your adrenaline rushes, it makes you tired because your body is constantly wearing itself out with worry. And mentally as well, you're always catastrophizing. The worst is going to happen in every situation. You put thoughts into people's heads, you know, oh, that person doesn't respect me, doesn't like me. They're going to see through me. They're going to, you know, spot any second that I'm a fraud. Worst case scenarios all the time. And then depression is like a sinking feeling, you know, like a constant sinking feeling where you just sink lower and lower and lower. This sort of deathly stillness, which is hiding a lot of pain. Relentlessly negative thoughts. You can't do that. You should give up. You should stop. You can't do this. Obsessively and negatively. It's not just having a bad day, it's having a bad 6 months or a bad year or a bad decade. And people can sometimes go through periods of low mood, but when it starts becoming sort of consistently relentlessly negative, self-judgmental, self-critical, that's when you know you've got a problem.
That's really helpful, David. We've spoken about this and you've said, actually, surprisingly, being Christian actually can make it worse sometimes. We were thinking about joy last Sunday evening. That command to rejoice can feel like a burden. But how has your Christian faith helped you in your struggles?
Yeah, I think all of what you said there is pretty accurate. You can definitely cherry pick the Bible to sort of attack yourself more. And I think people do that. I found that I reached this point where I was in free fall, and, you know, I wanted to die at times. I once locked myself in a cupboard for 6 hours because I just couldn't cope with having any space around me. It was just so overwhelming. And surprisingly, in that moment where I felt that God had abandoned me and I was so confused why he'd allowed me to go through such an awful awful experience. I unexpectedly found a flaw, like a foundation level, where I couldn't push through it. I was so low that getting any lower would have been probably very dangerous. And it was at that point that I realized that I knew somewhere solid, that was much more solid than the storm of the emotions and the storm of the criticism and the attacks I was making on myself. There was a hard place, a foundation where I knew that long term, God must have a purpose, must have a reason for allowing this constant, relentless suffering. Mm. You know?
Can you just give us a few tips as a church on how to look after and think about these issues?
Yeah, I think two things. Firstly, the person who is in the pit, the strength of your mental illness comes from its lack of challenge, because you can't challenge it, and the lack of truth and the twisted nature of the narrative in your head. Mm. And so it's really important that you speak up. And I don't mean this in that kind of cliched, you know, it's okay not to be okay way, which I think is just it's garbage. But in the sense of it, for a Christian, it really is normal to be broken. And if it's normal to be broken, and it's normal to be in pain, and normal to be in struggle, then it's important that you honestly share that with, I think, first of all, you know, the people closest to you. That could be your partner, it could be your family, your parents, your student leader, your whole group leader, all that stuff. But then also that you don't just give it all to one person and then expect them to look after you. You know, it's important to share that with as many people as possible, so they all have an accurate idea of where you are. Otherwise, you actually make it very difficult for them, because they feel like they're the only one who knows how you are really feeling. And to the church, I think, normalize brokenness. You know, we should celebrate with people who are celebrating and mourn with people who are mourning, right?
Yeah.
So it's very, very valuable to come to church with your sorrows and to share them and to feel free to need some prayer, to cry, to praise and to be joyful and just happy. You know, whatever you're going through, the honesty you can bring with your brokenness and your ups and downs are a very powerful challenge to people who feel like what they're going through is somehow unique.
Mm.
So you will take away the power of their own terrible internal narrative by sharing your challenges too.
Which it's very easy to look around and think that everyone's sorted, isn't it?
Yeah. I don't like Sunday game faces, John C.
Masks.
They condemn people.
Yeah. Yeah. David, that's really helpful. We'll be praying for you and for others as part of our service. Thank you.